Good evening. Welcome to you all to our service of worship here at Reynard Way, Northampton. Welcome to everyone online. Good you could be with us. And I'm going to begin with just a notice. Most notices, I won't repeat everything that's on here. But one notice didn't make it onto the sheet in time, but it's worth making it clear. On the 20th of May, next Saturday, there's the Ladies' Brunch in Spire. And the following Saturday, there's something else. There's a bit of confusion this morning. The 20th of May on a Saturday is a tea party, I'm told, for girls aged 11 to 18. It's kind of specific, I think, was the renewed group. And then anyone else who falls into that catchment who'd like to come to. That's at Mark and Margaret's house. I think they know about it. But they're not the ones to ask about it. Ask Louise and, yeah, anyone else? Ask Louise. Geraldine knows about it. Okay? I won't say any more. I don't know anymore. I won't say any more. Okay. We've come together because we love the Lord God. He has had mercy upon us, and he has revealed himself to us in his word and in the Lord Jesus Christ. And we want to worship him. We want to listen to him, learn of him, draw near to him. Romans 11 ends with these verses. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and how inscrutable his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord? Or who has been his counselor? Or who has given a gift to him that he might be repaid? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. Our first hymn reflects on the sovereignty of God, and what a thing that is for his people to know that he is in control. God moves in a mysterious way, his wonders to perform. He plants his footsteps in the sea and rides upon the storm. Deep in unfathomable mines of never failing skill, he treasures up his bright designs and works his sovereign will. You fearful saints, fresh courage take. The clouds you so much dread are big with mercy and shall break in blessings on your head. Let's sing. This is 256 if you're using a book. Words up here.
Thank you.
Well, let us pray. Our great and glorious God, our King, our Creator, our Sustainer, the Sovereign Lord of all the universe, our Father, we come to you as your children, so glad to be able to call you our Father, so glad to know that the one who rules the universe, who sits on the throne, who is almighty, is our loving Heavenly Father. And you care for us. We are precious to you. Lord, we've just sung often, you move in a mysterious way. We fail to understand your purposes and what you're doing. Lord, you have revealed so much to us in your word, but a lot of it we fail to grasp properly or understand as we ought. And often you don't tell us what is happening. And often in our lives, we go through things that are confusing and mysterious to us, frustrating to us. But Lord, we do trust that you are our Father who loves us, and you are the sovereign God of all things, and your purposes are perfect and good and unstoppable, and you will bring them about in your perfect timing, and we can trust you. Lord, we couldn't possibly understand everything anyway if you did explain it to us. But we do thank you that you are trustworthy. And we ask, Lord God, for grace and help to fresh courage take, to have confidence that you are at work in good and perfect ways in our lives and in this world. Help us to trust that the judge of all the earth always does what is right, always does what is best. You are a good Father to us. Lord, we praise you. We do worship you. Our loving Father, we want to pray that you would bless this world in which we live. You could tell us, pray your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, we've prayed many times over the last month or so, and we've prayed this morning for our country, in terms of the king. And he was crowned yesterday. Lord, in centuries past, that would have meant many changes probably. The king had great power, but that is not the case now. But he is a man of influence. He is someone who has a voice that is listened to, and a man who many follow and revere. And we pray for him now, Lord God, that he would be a man who can be entrusted with this responsibility. We pray, as we thought about this morning, he was given a Bible, and it won't be the first Bible in his life. Lord, we don't know what regard he has for the Bible. But we pray, Heavenly Father, you would put it on his heart to seek wisdom. We remember the young King Solomon, who, when crowned king, knew he wasn't up to the task, and he sought wisdom from you. And we pray, Lord, you would put this upon King Charles's heart to seek wisdom from God, Lord, to listen to the godly counselors in his life and to read the word and learn of you. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that he would come to know you as Father, the Lord Jesus as his King and Savior, and that he would live his life and in this position you put him for your glory, and that you would use him for good. We pray these things very much. We pray for our country, Lord God, a country that has departed from ways it once knew, once a very godly country, once described as a people who run after the book, but no longer. And Heavenly Father, we do so pray that you might work graciously in this land. Lord, the great act of grace is saving souls, and we pray, Heavenly Father, that you would bring many people to the Lord Jesus Christ. You would grant salvation to people everywhere, young and old. We pray, Father, very much for our young people. We pray for the youth in our country that has been so misled, so lied to by Satan, so deceived into believing that almost anything but God is the answer to life, and they pursue so many varied things. Often they are good things given by our loving Father in heaven, and yet they make them idols which can never deliver. Oh Lord God, we pray your mercy on the young of our nation, that you would bring about a great work of salvation amongst the young generations. Be in our schools, Lord God. So often they are places where lies are taught. And we do so pray, Lord God, that you would be with Christian teachers and Christian head teachers. You would enable them, embolden them to stand firm on what is true. And we pray, Lord God, that children will be taught truth and be set a godly example. And schools, rather than being a place that many Christian parents worry about sending their children, they will be a wonderful place where truth is upheld and where children come back different. Oh, Lord, we long that you would have mercy upon our land. Dear Father, we pray you'd help us as the church, the local church here, and the church. There are churches up and down the country. We pray you'd help Christians everywhere to show the wider society around them what life is meant to be like, what life is like lived under the lordship of the true King of Kings. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you would enable local churches to function together in a way that turns heads, that makes jaws drop, for people love each other and they care for each other and they meet one another's needs. They forgive. They are patient and kind, and they do good to one another and to those outside of the church. Lord, we pray that the church everywhere will be such a testimony to Christian life, that our lives would indeed adorn the gospel, make it look beautiful. Heavenly Father, we do so pray that you would help us as the church in this country to be what we're called to be, and that may be a means of great mercy and salvation to the wider community. Father, we need your help. We come confessing our sins, recognizing that we're not what we should be, not in our thinking, not in our attitudes, not in our speech and our actions. Lord, anything that is right about us has been done, produced by you. So much that is wrong with us is our own contribution. Oh, Father, forgive us, we pray. Cleanse us and empower us to live righteously, gracious God. Help us, Lord God. Give us wisdom where we lack it. We lack wisdom in so many areas. We need to be governed by your word. Here is wisdom. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that you would make us complete men and women of God through the scriptures as your Holy Spirit brings it home to our hearts. We ask, Lord God, that you would bless us here tonight, that you would do us great good as we spend this time together in your word, and later on around the communion table. We pray, Lord, that you would speak to us, that you would comfort, rebuke, direct, help us to hear your voice and to respond to what you're saying. Lord, we pray for a better understanding of your word, those mysterious ways. You have revealed so much to us. May we not be in the dark about things that you have declared to us. Help us to be diligent students of your word, children who love to hear what their father has done, what their father is up to. And we pray, Lord, that you would give us great delight in what is your business. As Jesus said, I must be about my father's business. May that be true of us. Lord, we pray that you would draw very near to those who are of our number, who are struggling in deep and troubling ways. Oh, Lord, we pray that you would bring comfort, bring hope, bring reassurance, increase our confidence in you, as we prayed at the beginning, that our trust might increase, that we wouldn't dishonor you with a lack of trust, that we would know that, yes, you can be trusted. We will be okay. God is in control. Help us, Lord, in this. We commit this time then to you, Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to read from Genesis, okay, so the first book of the Bible in the early chapters. We've been We've just begun, really, a series looking at the covenants of God in the Bible. God makes covenants with man, and they are hugely significant. We are ignorant of them at our peril. And we looked at the first, I'll recap a little bit of that in the sermon, and it takes us directly into the second, which we're going to read about now, the covenant that God made through Noah, with Noah and through him to with us all. So what I'm going to do is read chapter 6 to 9. Not quite. I'm going to select verses. It's a long reading. But this is the story of the flood. Very familiar, at least in its most elemental points of the story. It's a well-known story. I'm going to select parts of it. So I'm going to start in chapter 6 and read verse 5 down to 13. The Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord regretted that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him to his heart. So the Lord said, I will blot out man, whom I have created from the face of the land, man and animals and creeping things and birds of the heavens, for I am sorry that I have made them. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. These are the generations of Noah. Noah was a righteous man, blameless in his generation. Noah walked with God. And Noah had three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight, and the earth was filled with violence. And God saw the earth, and behold, it was corrupt. For all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. And God said to Noah, I have determined to make an end of all flesh, for the earth is filled with violence through them. Behold, I will destroy them with the earth. Then Noah is instructed to build an ark, and he gives the instructions about the animals that he's going to take into the ark with him. And Noah obeys God, and he builds an ark. Those few verses probably cover 100 years to build this vast boat. We're going to read on from chapter 7 now, verses 1 to 6. Then the Lord said to Noah, go into the ark, you and all your household, for I have seen that you are righteous before me in this generation. Take with you 7 pairs of all the clean animals, the male and his mate, and a pair of the animals that are not clean, the male and his mate, and 7 pairs of the birds of the heavens also, male and female, to keep their offspring alive on the face of the earth. For in 7 days I will send rain on the earth, 40 days and 40 nights, and every living thing that I've made I will blot out from the face of the ground. And Noah did all that the Lord had commanded him. Noah was 600 years old when the flood of waters came upon the earth. Now drop down to verse 15. They went into the ark with Noah, 2 and 2 of all flesh, in which there was the breath of life. And those that entered, male and female of all flesh, went in as God had commanded him, and the Lord shut him in. Let's go down to verse 22. Everything on the dry land in whose nostrils was the breath of life died. God blotted out every living thing that was on the face of the ground, man and animals and creeping things and birds of the heavens. They were blotted out from the earth. Only Noah was left, and those who were with him in the ark. And the waters prevailed on the earth 150 days. But God remembered Noah and all the beasts and all the livestock that were with him in the ark. And God made a wind blow over the earth, and the waters subsided. The fountains of the deep and the windows of the heavens were closed. The rain from the heavens was restrained, and the waters receded from the earth continually. At the end of 150 days, the waters had abated. You drop down now to verse 20. And eventually the water subsided enough, and they came out onto dry land. I'm going to read from verse 20 and then through to chapter 9, verse 17. Then Noah built an altar to the Lord and took some of every clean animal and some of every clean bird and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And when the Lord smelled the pleasing aroma, the Lord said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground because of man, for the intention of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I ever again strike down every living creature as I have done. While the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night shall not cease. And God blessed Noah and his sons and said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. The fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth and upon every bird of the heavens, upon everything that creeps on the ground and all the fish of the sea. Into your hand they are delivered. Every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. And as I gave you the green plants, I give you everything. But you shall not eat flesh with its life, that is, its blood. And for your lifeblood, I will require a reckoning. From every beast I will require it, and from man. From his fellow man I will require a reckoning for the life of man. Whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed. For God made man in his own image. And you, be fruitful and multiply. Increase greatly on the earth and multiply in it. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, behold, I establish my covenant with you and your offspring after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the livestock, and every beast of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark, it is for every beast of the earth. I establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of the flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth. And God said, this is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth, and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh, and the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth. God said to Noah, this is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth. We'll look at that in a moment. We're going to sing, first of all, a hymn about our faith. When I fear my faith will fail, Christ will hold me fast. Let's sing this to the Lord and to one another. I wrote at the top of your sermon notes that the title is, this is the Noahic Covenant. If anyone knows how to pronounce that, please tell me later. The covenant God made with Noah. I've written Know Your Constitution. This has been a big weekend for our country. We live in a constitutional monarchy. And we've got a new king. A new king was crowned. So that's a big thing for a constitutional monarchy. It's exciting. Except that nothing's really going to change because our monarch has very little actual power. We have a constitution in the United Kingdom which has various principles, including parliamentary sovereignty and the rule of law. And the king submits to that, same as everybody else. Our constitution enshrines these various things as governing principles: parliamentary sovereignty, rule of law, democracy, internationalism. Shall we talk about those things now? Let's not. But, of course, not every country is like the United Kingdom. Other countries organise themselves differently, and they've got their own constitutions. So when you travel to another country, it's always a good idea to be very clear what the rules are before you arrive, because what may be okay in your country, you may not be okay there. Now, our subject is not the various constitutions of the nations, but in this series of sermons, we're looking at the covenants that God has made with man. And these make up the constitution. The constitution for planet Earth. The constitution for the human race. These are the governing principles of the whole planet. And these covenants trump everything else. These come first. They override all human constitutions. Are you familiar with them? Very important that you are. Do you know the constitution that you live under? Well, we're going to recap the first covenant and look at the second this evening. The first covenant we looked at last week is the founding covenant. We had the founding governing principles for the human race. It's been called the Adamic covenant, the covenant of works. And God made this covenant with the whole human race through a representative human being, the first man, who was called Adam. Adam was called by God to rule the world in God's name. He was made in God's image. He was called to be the king and had dominion over all that God had made. He was called to keep and guard the world as this holy place where man and God dwell together. So he was called to be a priest. And he was called to declare God's word and uphold God's word and see that God's word is lived by and adhered to. He was the prophet of God, prophet, priest, and king of the earth. That's what we are meant to be. That's as God's image bearers on earth, this is what we're called to. And for God's part, he would bless Adam and all of us with eternal life with him. That was the glory that was held out to us in this covenant. But you know the story. Adam's faithfulness was put to the test. Faithfulness to this covenant. Would he indeed rule all the world in God's name and guard and keep it holy and uphold God's word? God tested him in just one small corner of the globe. This garden, the Garden of Eden. Would Adam rule the garden in God's name? Or would he reject God and seek to rule it in his own name? And you know what happened. Satan came in with a sneering lie. He came in with a lie that God can't be trusted. God is not good. And Adam believed Satan and disobeyed God. He broke the covenant, and thus he brought the covenant curses down on his head. But not just on his head, because he was our representative. We are in him. And so the whole human race came under the curse of God, you and me. We're all born into that covenant. It's a failed covenant. But we're all born into it. We are all called to be what God made us to be, his image bearers on earth, ruling the world in his name, individually in your corner. You rule over your heart and in your influence. You're called to live as God would have you live and be priest and prophet and king, as it were. It's still your constitutional duty to your creator and king. So you have this mandate from your creator. But we've rejected him and we've set up as though we are gods, and as though we are able to live as we please, and so we die. We're under this covenant curse. We're born in this state of spiritual deadness, and we're separated from God, and we will die finally and eternally. But at the very moment of failure, of utter disaster, God made this glorious, glorious promise. In chapter 3, verse 15, God addresses Satan and tells him, I'm going to put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. And God addresses this one who has brought about the ruin of man and says, I'm going to send someone to destroy you. There is a savior coming. And then begins, that's the story of the Bible. From there in, that's the story. That's the plot. The story of the crusher, the coming savior who will come and crush Satan's head. But what quickly emerges, read into chapter 4, and you start asking the question, how could this possibly ever happen? Because almost immediately the whole thing looks extremely unlikely, if not impossible. Chapter 4, I won't read it now, but there you get the first family, torn apart by hatred and murder. Eve gives birth to a son, Cain, followed by another son, Abel. Cain kills Abel. Typical family. The first big brother murders the first little brother, and it's downhill from there. And as the family grows and becomes a people and the world begins to populate, it's very clear people are so changed from what God made them. They were made in the image of God, but now they're corrupt, they're twisted, they're evil. And by the time you get to chapter 6, God looks at what he has made, and we read this in verse 11. Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight. The earth was filled with violence, and God saw the earth, and behold, it was corrupt. Can you hear the echoes there of Genesis chapter 1 when God first made the world? Genesis 1 verse 31, and God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. But now he beholds everything, and it's corrupt. Ruined. Looks like the world, the human race, is going to destroy itself long before any savior will come. By Genesis 6, the world is full of people, and only one of them walks with God, and that's Noah. It's one righteous man. How long will the righteous line survive? We're down to one already. So God sends the flood. God saw that the wickedness of man was great on the earth, and every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And God regretted that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him to his heart. So the Lord said, I will blot out man whom I have created from the face of the land. So the flood is God's judgment on mankind. Now that could be our focus this evening, and it's not going to be. I just say this because I know that this judgment seen in the flood is very difficult for many people. They balk at this, and I do want to recognize that and say, that's not our focus this evening. We did have a sermon on that during lockdown, so if you want to find that online, it specifically deals with the judgment of man in the flood. So that is a problem, a concern. It's a legitimate concern. What's happening here? You can listen to that. But our focus is on what happens after the flood. The covenant that God makes with Noah. After the flood, the question looms large. How can the promise of a savior survive in a world like this? A world that self-destructs in its own wickedness. A world that God ought to judge right now and annihilate. How is this God's plan of salvation? How is that ever going to come about? What is God's answer? The answer is he makes another covenant. He says, I'm going to deal with this through covenant. The Noahic covenant, it has a very specific purpose. It isn't a salvation covenant. You can't be saved through this covenant. It's doing something else. All covenants, remember, are for the blessing of man. God blesses through covenants. And the blessing here, the function of this covenant, is to provide a stable platform for God's plan of salvation to be worked out. The great salvation story is about to unfold. What chance is there in a world like this It's like a glorious play, but before the play can begin, you need to get the stage sorted out and prepared. God has made this promise of salvation, this one who will come, but for that to happen, man mustn't be allowed to destroy everything first. And nor must God. This covenant is designed to preserve, protect, keep the world from self-destruction and from divine destruction. It safeguards the world to make it possible for the promises of God to come through. Once again, God works through a representative, it's Noah. And through Noah, God makes a covenant with the human race, and we'll see also with everything, with all living things, all the world, and a covenant with you. So the thing is, this covenant's still operative. It's not cancelled out until the end of all things. This covenant's still operative. If you're unaware of what follows now, listen carefully, because you're involved here. This is the constitution that you live under, living in this world. You will be held to this. Now, three things we're going to look at here. This covenant governs our relationship with creation, our relationships with one another, and our relationship with God. So let's begin our relationship with creation. So we're in verse chapter 9 now. And notice how much of this is strangely familiar. Chapter 9, verse 1. And God blessed Noah and his sons and said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth." Does that ring a bell? That's what he said to Adam and Eve right at the beginning, wasn't it? It's just like as a second creation. In many ways, that is what it's like. In the whole account, there are echoes of creation, the deep covering the face of the earth, the wind blowing on it, land and sea being separated. There's birds in the air and animals and vegetation. It echoes the creation. But of course, it's not the same. Oh, no, because death is now on the scene. Death is everywhere. This is a cursed world. It's not paradise. And what's more, the sin that brought death is here too. Sin survived the flood. The flood didn't make Noah righteous. Man is still corrupted. So this is not a simple resetting of the system. This is not take two, now we'll be fine. He goes on. Chapter 9 then. God blessed Noah and his sons and said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. The fear of you and the dread of you will be upon every beast of the earth and upon every bird of the heavens, upon everything that creeps on the ground, and all the fish of the sea into your hand. They are delivered. Every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. As I gave you the green plants, now I give you everything, but you shall not eat flesh with its life," that is, its blood. What is happening here? The human race is still called to rule. That's not been set aside. His role is being reiterated. The mandate to rule still stands. You're the king of this domain. It hasn't changed. But of course, what is very true is the curse has made it 1,000 times harder. It's become nigh on impossible now. And God knows that. And so he says, the fear and dread of you shall be upon every beast of all the creatures. They're going to have to rule now. With a much firmer hand. Everything has got tougher. And God is saying, yeah, it's got way tougher. He gives them the animals to eat now. I think it's probably a necessity. You're going to have to eat some of these things before they eat you. The world has changed. But there is, at the same time, this great respect and regard. That's what verse 4 is about. You shall not eat flesh with its life, that is, its blood. You still got to regard God's creation as a sacred and precious thing and regard it sacredly. As precious. Do you see what's happened? The curse has not let man off the hook. And it has got, he still rules, but it's got massively harder. What's the temptation? Don't bother. Don't bother. What's your garden like? I've been thinking about this. The Garden of Eden, that was his domain. No curse. Everything grew lovely. There weren't diseases. It wasn't going to be hard in that sense. And the animals weren't going to kill him or bite him or be difficult. It was wonderful. I mean, it was still work, but it wouldn't be terrible. I walk my dog pretty much every day in Abington Park. and looking around thinking, this is such a beautiful park. It's one of the highlights of moving to Northampton is the park. It's just lovely. And as you go around, and I was thinking, because I've been thinking about this, I was thinking, how much work is it to keep this place lovely? The labour that goes on, I hardly ever see it, not around when it's happening, but they work hard to keep everything growing beautifully. And on a lovely sunny day, they're on bank holiday, everyone comes out and enjoys it, and it's beautiful. Something Garden of Eden-ish about it. Until you look closely. Yes, it must be hard work, because now the ground might be hard and might freeze in winter, and there's probably diseases and pests and bad weather and all kinds of things that make it harder. But there's other things too. There are signs up. 24-hour camera surveillance here. Why? Because of people and what they might do. There's a sign, there's a dozen signs that say, please do not urinate. Seriously? You go to the lake, there's this beautiful lake. I was there this morning and there's a guy feeding the bread to the ducks. And just over to this side is a sign that says, please do not feed the ducks bread, it makes them ill. And then next to the sign was a bin, a litter bin, and in the lake was cans of beer and a balloon right by the bin. What's the problem? It's people. It's sin, isn't it? We live in a world under a curse. The actual creation has been cursed, and we are sinful and wicked. And what's the instinct? Oh, forget it. Forget it. But God says, no. The mandate remains. You must rule. And we still have this duty to the created order. So we are the stewards of this world. We don't have a mandate here to be cruel and ransack the environment, but to subdue the earth. And Noah knows, is told frankly by God, you are now going to have to rule through fear and force. But you must rule. Since the fall, creation bites back. But no, that's not an excuse to give up. You rule. And we must. The curse on the earth has made our mandate harder, but we still have this call to build and cultivate and expand and construct human civilization. No excuses, despite the fact it's going to be blood, sweat, and tears now. We're called to work for a stable, successful society, for cultural achievement, for growth, for all that man made us to be and made the world to be. Don't just sit around. We still have this mandate. We must labour. No quitting, no chilling, no idling. Play your part, though it's going to be hard. So God reiterates that. This is your relationship with the creation. You're still the king. Our relationship now with one another. He talks about that now, verse 5. And for your lifeblood I will require a reckoning. From every beast I will require it, and from man. From his fellow man I will require a reckoning for the life of man. Whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed. For God made man in his own image. God is laying down principles of justice here. Sin is going to erupt again. And left unchecked, it will just wipe them out. Again. So God requires man to deal correctly with it this time. Genesis 4 records two acts of violence, and neither of them were dealt with properly. Abel's murder went unavenged. Then later on, a man called Lamech comes along. We're told that he was injured by a young boy, so he killed him. And he actually crows about it. And God says, no, from now on, justice must be done. You must do it. God lays down a strict rule of retribution. The punishment is to fit the crime. And that means murderers must be executed. Straight with that. And he gives the reason. Whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed. For God made man in his own image. Made in the image of God. Thomas Watson, Puritan writer, 17th century, wrote this. Whenever you harm another human being, you are tearing God's picture. It's a very good way of thinking about it. An assault on a human being in God's image is an assault on God. You've ever seen somebody tear up someone's photo? Maybe you've done it. Everyone knows what that means. and knows what you're thinking, what you think of that person. You're tearing up their image. Whenever you harm a human being, you're attacking God. And as a creature made in the image of God, man is precious. He is priceless. People are priceless, more so than we realize. And many people look at this and think, this is primitive, it's barbaric. But actually, it's quite the opposite. This is all written down by Moses. And in Moses' time, this was revolutionary. This was unheard of. This marked a huge advance in the dignity of every individual. Nothing can pay for a human life. If you say you kill someone, the penalty is £10,000. You just priced a human life, £10,000. You say 30 years in prison. After 30 years, you're free to go. You put a price on the human life. I remember not so long ago, the parents of a murdered daughter speaking on the news. The murderer got 15 years. And they cried and they said this: we thought our daughter was worth more than that. And they were right. See, this verse is saying that nothing can be exchanged for a human life other than its own currency. Only a life will pay for a life. Human life is priceless. Now, the ancient codes in Moses' time, they had a class distinction. So if a poor man kills a rich man, the rich family could kill that man and his entire family. But if a rich man killed a poor man, he had to pay a fine to compensate the family. So lives had different values. People had different value. God says, no, every human individual life is priceless. It is sacred. Nothing can pay for it but itself. And you remember how Jesus pushes this deep to the heart. He says, this is a heart issue. Matthew chapter 5, he says, if you hate someone, if you disdain someone, if you dismiss someone, if you regard someone as unimportant and beneath you, Jesus says, you've murdered them in your heart. And God will hold you accountable. There's a sacred trust that God places upon you with every human being who he brings into your life. Every human being you rub along next to, he will hold you accountable to how you treat them. Notice the way God speaks about this in verse 5. For your lifeblood, I will require a reckoning. I will require a reckoning for the life of man. What does this mean? God requires a reckoning in the same way that if I borrowed your car and damaged it, you would require some kind of reckoning. Can you pay for that? It's my car, and look what you've done. God is saying, these people are mine. Human life is mine. I made them. They belong to me. Human life is sacred. It's not yours. You're accountable for it. He demands an accounting. Every human life that comes into your life, into your family, the people in your house, your neighbors, the postman, people on the bus, that person who smells bad, kids in your school that you can't stand, you're accountable for that human life. So they are a sacred deposit in your hands. They are priceless. God holds you accountable how you treat them. They're not yours. They are people owned by someone else, by God who made them. So we see this covenant, it deals with how we live together in this fallen world, that we must ensure that the sacred dignity of human life is honored. He's preserving life in this cursed world. God is requiring us to get it right. Noah, get it right. It has to be done right. He's putting this safeguard around people, around the human race, so it's not going to snuff itself out. This is God's common grace to us all. After saying that, God says, verse 7, and you be fruitful and multiply, increase greatly on the earth and multiply in it. That's what God wants for us, not for us to be slaughtering each other. So this is our side of the covenant. How are you doing? Do you feel up to it? This is the constitution that governs our lives. Does it condemn you? It does. It condemns all of us, doesn't it? It does condemn us. How are we ever going to live like this? Well, we need to see this third thing. How are you relating to God? See, that's our side of the covenant. Fulfill this mandate to rule and subdue the earth, to make it glorious despite the curse, maintain justice, dealing with one another as creatures made in God's image. What's on God's side of the covenant? God makes a promise. Verse 8, then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, behold, I establish my covenant with you and your offspring after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the livestock, and every beast of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. It is for every beast of the earth. It's making a covenant with all life. I establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of the flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth. God will preserve the earth. He makes this promise to everything, every living thing. He's never going to destroy the world in that way again. God is promising to preserve the creation until that final end. As he says in the end of chapter 8, verse 22, while the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night shall not cease. God is going to keep the world turning, if you like. And it is a covenant of common grace that God is going to keep the world functioning and providing. Jesus puts it later, he said, God sends the rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. He causes the sun to shine on the good and the bad. He is going to preserve this creation and the earth as the arena in which salvation is going to play out. The salvation plan is going to happen. The Savior will come. And this world is going to be preserved until that time. It's going to happen. He's not going to let man ruin things. He insists that we care for the world and we care for one another. And at the same time, he's going to hold off divine justice. Because it's not like we're not going to deserve it again. He says, I'm not going to do it. What about sanctions? Come on, where's the sanctions? We looked at covenants. They all have sanctions. You do this and all this will happen. You do this and all this will happen. Where's the sanctions? Can you see any? Does God say what will happen if man fails to play his part? No, there's nothing here. Nothing here. And that is amazing because we know from history that man has an appalling record. He has ransacked the planet. Far from being a steward of the earth, he's brutalized the natural world. This is the thing that our new king is big on, isn't he? He's so concerned about this. That how we treated the environment, how we treated the world we live in. And he's right to raise that. But what's the other part of our mandate, our calling? It's justice and the preservation of human life. We're precious. Why isn't the king banging on about that? Why is he not talking about abortion? That is the great example of this, isn't it? We had in the news recently that terrible, terrible wickedness of a nurse who has apparently murdered babies. But you can be sure what else goes on in that hospital. They sanction it in the ward down the road, down the way. We murder our babies. God says, I demand a reckoning for that. They're my babies. I made them. And yet, there seem to be no sanctions recorded here. This is a covenant of grace, not saving grace. No one is saved here. Eternally. But this is a covenant of common grace. God says, I'm going to keep this world going. I'm telling you what to do, but I'm not saying what I'm going to do if you don't do it. And we know that throughout the history of the world, throughout the history of in the Bible, there are local judgments. God does judge and God does deal with wickedness, but he never gives us what we deserve. He's holding back all the time. The flood says, this is what you deserve. And Noah got mercy, not that he deserved it. But God is now holding it off gloriously. No sanctions here. But there is a covenant sign. Covenants typically have a symbolic sign. You know, if you go to a wedding, there's a symbol of the covenant they made, and it's normally rings, isn't it? We exchange rings. Coronation yesterday, it was full of signs and symbols, wasn't it? Biblical covenants tended to be signified with an animal being cut in half and the pieces separated and they'd walk between the two. The sign of the covenant here, none of the above, it is a rainbow. Verse 12, God said, this is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all generations. I have set my bow in the cloud and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. It's the It's in this covenant sign that we learn about our relationship with God and how it has to work if there is to be a relationship. No other way. The rainbow, rainbow's an English word. They don't have a word in Hebrew for what we call a rainbow. The word you're seeing here is the word kesheth, which is probably pronounced wrong, begins with a Q. But what it means is a war bow, the weapon, a bow. A bow and arrow. And the key to understanding this is to understand that's what he's talking about. My bow, you'll see it in the sky. See, in the Psalms, God talks about his justice and his judgment in terms of firing arrows. God launches his arrows at the wicked. He has his bow and he draws back and he fires. In other places, it talks about the lightning from God as his arrows hurtling down on the wicked. It's a picture of God's judgment. And now you get it. Now you think, all right, I get the rainbow. Here's the sanction. I've set my sign in the sky and I'm ready for you. One, you mess this up and down come my arrows of judgment. That would make perfect sense if rainbows were the other way around. But what do they look like? They're not pointing down at us. They're a big arch like this. You see, who does God say the covenant sign is for? If it was that way up, we'd be looking at it all the time, saying, oh, remember what we've got to do, because those arrows are coming our way. But no, God says, I'm the one who looks at this. When I bring the clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant. That is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the water shall never again become a flood to destroy your flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it. And remember, well, who cares if you see it or not? I'm the one who's looking, and I want you to know that I'm looking. I'm going to keep my promise. I'm not going to wipe you out, though you absolutely deserve it. You see what's happening? In the rainbow, God is giving us a picture and a symbol to teach us about his grace. His arrows are aiming up. They're aiming into his own heart. God has set up the symbol to say, I'm holding myself to this. You deserve it, but I will take it. See, you can't relate to God in terms of merit. There's no point you can come to God and say, you owe me. None at all. Not for any of us. He does owe us judgment, and that's it. And that would be fair. We cannot relate to God in terms of merit. We can only relate to him in terms of grace. If it was merit, how would you be doing? If God said, yes, you can earn your way into my favor, you can earn your way to heaven, here's the covenant, how are you getting on with this mandate? Do you rule your sphere of life, even over your own heart, according to the righteousness of God? Do you uphold God's word? Do you keep your own heart as a holy place for God to dwell? And do you treat every person in your life with this dignity, this as a priceless creation of God, made in his image? None of us do. None of us do. We are murderers at heart. If we come to God in terms of merit, we are doomed. The only hope is that we are able to come to God in terms of grace. And the rainbow says that is the only hope, and it's there. He's teaching us about grace. The symbol of a bow tells us God does judge sin. But the fact that it's not pointing at you, it's pointing at him, tells you. Tells you about the cross, actually, doesn't it? Because that's where it happens. That's where it happens. You think about rainbows. Where do you find them? You always find them on a dark, rainy day, and the sun comes out. It's the overlap between the dark and the light. It's the overlap between the wrath of God and the mercy and love of God. That's the cross. That's where that happened. The wrath of God and the love and mercy of God came together. The arrows of God's wrath were fired and Jesus took them in our place. This is what we have to understand from this. And this is the only way we can relate to God. When we look at this covenant, it does condemn us. But what empowers us to keep going? What empowers us to say, I'm going to press on and I'm going to try and live like this. I'm going to love like this. Love like my Savior. It's knowing about the rainbow. It's knowing about the cross. It's understanding what that means. Listen, I wonder, are you a Christian? Anyone here is not a Christian? I don't know everybody. And I don't know where everyone's heart is either, but you have to come to God in terms of grace. You have to come to God not assuming that you're going to be okay because you're doing well. Because God sees the heart and says, you're not doing well. None of you are doing well. If you want to see what someone looks like who's doing well, look at Jesus. That was good enough, says God. If you like him, you're okay, but you're not. You're not. But you can come to me on these terms. He came to die instead of you. He came and lived the life that you should have lived, and he's prepared to say, I credit that to you. And I'll take your sin on myself, and I'll go and stand on the target and have the arrows land in my heart. You can come in those terms. You can come saying, yes, please, do that for me. Be my saviour. I'm a sinner and I can only appeal to your mercy. God says, yes, good, come. I accept that because I want to save you. God is a just God and will punish sin, but he's a merciful God. He loves to forgive. Amen. He loves to save. And he calls, he says, come, come. Why would you die? You don't have to. That's the gospel. We're going to talk a little bit more about this, but we're going to sing first, and then we're going to come around the table and have the bread and wine together and think further about it. We want to sing this song. This is a hymn that is familiar, but it's not. Don't be caught out, because the words aren't quite what you might expect. This is a version of it that's actually written by the wife of one of my lecturers when I was at Bible college. But it speaks about the cross, and it speaks about the rainbow. O Lord my God, I stand and gaze in wonder on the vast heavens thy wisdom hath ordained. Let's sing this together. close this part of the service with prayer, and we say goodbye to the folks online. Our gracious Lord, how we thank you for your mercy to us, expressed in that beautiful way in the rainbow, but pointing us to the reality of the cross. We thank you, Lord, that we can have a relationship with you through the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray that we might walk in the joy of that relationship this week. Lord, we commit each other into your hands. In Jesus' name, amen.